the meeting.
Oh.
Can I go now?
You're good, you're good, thank you.
Okay, can I have your attention, please? Please silence your cell phones. This is a call to order, this is a meeting of the Board of Supervisors at Point Sienna CED. It's October 18th, 2017, in Starlight Ballroom on Village Drive, Point Sienna. First item on the agenda is a roll call. Bob Zimbardi is here.
David Lane here.
Lee Epstein here.
Skip Stelfox here.
Dick Kellogg here.
So we have a call. Let the record show that we also have in attendance Lindsay Whalen, District Counsel, Mike Delasolo, District Engineer Representative, and Michael Eckert, District Counsel. Okay, next item on the agenda is audience comments. Board will entertain comments related to agenda, I'm sorry, Pledge of Allegiance, I apologize. I pledge allegiance
to the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, next item, audience comments, or board will entertain comments related to items on the agenda. Okay, there being none, moving on to the next item. It's approval of the August 16th, 2017 meeting minutes. All board members have received a copy, are there any additions, corrections, or deletions?
Move approval.
Dick Kellogg, second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carried. Next item on the agenda is the District Manager's Report. Mr. Walter.
Good morning, Board. And a beautiful day starting off. Your financial reports are in your packet. You're doing quite well financially. There, we are time of year where we do the true up, and that is the General Fund Resolution 2018-06, amending the general fund, basically doing a reconciliation for the end of the year budget. In general, your services and fees were about as budgeted. Nothing extraneous came about. Your engineering fees were real high last year. Those were all anticipated and requested services. And that's where we are. So if there's any questions, I'd be happy to entertain them before we go to the resolution.
I have a question for you. On your memorandum, you talk about the additional charges for postage and printing and office supplies, and it says due to merger. Could you please tell me what you mean by merger?
Well, through the sale, considering that we're having dual meetings of the Point Sienna and Point Sienna West meeting together, merger may not have been the correct term, but it's the having those dual meetings.
Okay, I understood, but I didn't understand the word merger when I saw it.
Requesting change that?
Yeah.
So Chuck, am I to understand that the additional joint meetings, the fees that we receive as supervisors are being placed in this budget?
They're being split between Point Sienna and Point Sienna.
Correct, but for me as an individual, when we come to meeting, we get paid for both this meeting and the joint meeting. So that's the overage that we're talking about here.
No, I believe what Supervisor Lane is discussing is with all the extra administrative fees.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Correct. Yeah, I would like you to use a different term than merger because I think that could be misconstrued.
We'll just call it the joint meetings.
Okay.
Okay, and with that, I guess I would like to ask for a...
Hold on
okay.
A second.
That's fine.
I have a question. On the very first page, where it says debt service funds, you said revenues are from approximately 102%. And then you have a bullet underneath that says property service, property appraiser. Marsha 4, blah, blah, blah. Can you point that out?
Right, right.
Now, where is that? Very first page.
Right.
Very bottom. Can you point that out? Where is that in the financials?
Okay.
Where is it?
It's on the memorandum.
Oh, okay.
No, I know.
I'm sorry, the budget.
Yeah.
I was trying to find it.
Go to page 14 of your budget.
14. Page 14.
Miscellaneous assessment, collection costs.
How much check register, right?
No, sir, page 14 of your budget.
We don't have it.
There is no 14.
No 14. Page 14.
Can you pass?
It's two page numbers, it's top and bottom.
Yeah, top.
Okay.
Go down the administrative charges. Administration.
Okay.
Miscellaneous assessment, collection costs. About the third from the bottom in the administrative.
It says expenditures.
That's not.
Correct. Why does it say revenues? We're under total revenues.
That's provided that information, this is the, I believe.
The bullet says total revenues.
Right. We're approximately 102%, as provided by the property appraiser, Marshall Barnes.
And the revenues are shown under the debt service, so that's the debt of page 16. The passive actual revenue.
101.6.
Under 1.61.
Yeah.
The statement of revenues, expenses, and changes in fund balances.
That shows your collection for debt service.
Section 101.61, so it's rounded up to 102.
So it's not page 14, it's page 16?
Agenda page 16. Versus page 16.
Agenda, that's Tom.
Okay. Hang on, I got a couple more, I'm sorry. I wanted to get these straightened out in my mind. Okay, your agenda page 14.
Okay.
Yes.
Under expenditures, I understand a lot of the overruns due to additional meetings and stuff and additional work. But we're talking about here, the insurance, general liability went down. My question is, are coverage the same?
Yes.
And insurance went down?
Yes.
Okay. I guess my other question is on R&amp;M drainage. Does this have that in, is this the monies that we have authorized for repairs?
Yes.
Okay, on page 21, agenda page 21. Yet the outstanding check for Seven Trent Environmental Services for $13,875. I looked at page 14 of the check register, and 14 on the bottom. And I see that number, but what are all of these items for? A total of $13,875.
Those. If you go back to page 14 of your budget, you see that you have Seven Trent charges under management consulting services and under field professional services management. Those funds are going to those two expenditures, or they are going to the drainage R&amp;M. And I can find out specifically for you, but I can't tell you right now. Those are the three things that you are being charged for. I can find that out.
I don't, I still don't follow.
There's three items where you pay Severn Trent Services. One is for the drainage R&amp;M, one is for professional field management services, and one is for management services. Those are the only things that you pay us Severn Trent for. I don't know which one of those services you're paying for with the $13,000. I can check.
We have a list of five checks.
We have a list of five checks.
Page 27.
Yeah, there's a check.
Okay, I'm looking at 21, sir.
Yeah, it was page 14, you checked that, she had agenda page 27.
Okay, they're laying out. Okay, so I guess everyone's there.
I don't understand the charges. Management consulting services, who's that?
That's the back office preparing this book, and me, and your accounting services, doing all payroll. That's your management services.
For one month?
Yes.
I'll have to go back and look at the other charges. And all of this, and the next item now?
Correct, the same thing, those are monthly.
Field management, and I see another field manager.
Yes.
Yes. I don't understand. We have a flat rate for field management, do we not?
That's correct, but you also have the R&amp;M drain.
That's not what it says.
I understand. Okay, I will find out for you, sir.
Sounds to me like we need to get these check registers in more detail. If you're going to write a check for a large amount of money, I think we need it broken down for you.
Well, at least get the GL.
Well, the check register is actually there. What you're asking to see is the invoice detail, correct?
Well, how much more detail do you need? This specifically says what is.
It says it for field management, and it's not for field management.
Yes,
what is accuracy?
I believe it is, but I will check to find out what it is. I'm not going to.
Field management is Russ Simmons' charge, is it not?
Correct.
Okay.
And now you have two charges.
I got two.
I understand the question. I will try to find you the answer. I don't want to give you the incorrect answer.
Okay. And just while we're there on agenda page 27, can we look at agenda page 26? There's a check there for Atkins, and it says amenity acquisition. Now, we're paying this bill. Where do I see the revenue from AV Homes payback?
I've been having that conversation myself. These are being paid for out of the district as we wait for the AV Homes to reimburse for those expenses. They have to show up somewhere, and that's what we're doing.
But they're written on our checks.
Yes.
Okay, where's the payback? I don't see that.
You want to see the revenue?
Sure.
To date?
Sure, absolutely.
So you're looking for reconciliation?
Yes, if that's the right term, yes.
Reconciliation.
And that goes with Poppy Green and Sam's charges. We're in a building, whatever there's a charge for the amenity acquisition. One place you call it amenity acquisition, another one you call it project construction, sale, rec facility. There's a little different word.
Let's just say we want to see the cash flow.
Chuck, would it be prudent to have a separate sheet that would show us specifically what the overall costs are for the amenity acquisition so that we could review it and say, this is Hoppy Marine and Sam's, this is Severn Trent, these are the numbers, and this is on a monthly basis what AV Homes needs to reimburse us for, but it's showing up in detail on this report, but this is the overall cost and the detail of that. Would that be able to be done?
I think so. I'm writing down very similar notes. I think that's
would satisfy you.
Sure.
Yeah.
On agenda page 13, it shows due from developer $273,726.
I'm sorry, please start again.
Agenda page 13.
Yeah.
probably for a monthly billing. I mean, it's a month behind, so this is probably billing for October time, engineering services, things like that, but obviously Chuck can confirm that.
And I'm sorry, I didn't hear the question, I just got...
I'm just asking, we have due for developer, that amount, we're just not seeing the cash flow coming back.
Agenda page 13.
It's not showing any revenue coming in for the developer in any of our statements.
Right, so you're looking for, where are you gonna get this $233,000, correct?
No, we're looking for, when did we get it and against what?
Right, that's the reconciliation that I believe...
Correct.
Okay, I understand the question. I think we can provide that for you.
Very good.
One last question on agenda page 24, we're still in the check register.
Page 24?
Yeah, agenda page 24. About the middle of the page, who is Rogers Week? Payment description, Rogers Week.
Yes.
Who is Rogers Week?
Those actually have been removed from, thank you for bringing it up. Those have been removed, they were temporary labor charges we were using to map out the drainage services. We had thrown those costs, so those charges have been reversed.
I don't see that.
I know, and I'm letting you know that for the record.
Okay, and the same thing goes down on the next page, agenda page 25.
For Rogers.
For Environmental Financial Group, same issue, it says validation hearing services, so I'd like to see, you know, the revenue coming back.
Right, we'll get that team one coming.
That's all I have on that. Any other questions? I have a motion, obviously, to approve the financials, accept the check register as modified. Is that right, Tom?
Yes.
Can I motion?
I'll make the motion.
All right, I'll second it.
Do you have any more questions? No? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
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 All opposed? Motion carried. Next item on the agenda is the resolution of the 2018-06, is resolution 2018-06, amending the general fund budget for fiscal year 2017. Any board members have any questions regarding that resolution? None? Have a motion to approve resolution 2018-06.
I'll make the motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carried. Next item is a motion assigning fund balances as of September 30th. District manager, just please give a few words about this.
Assigning the fund balance is basically the rollover of your existing assets and not liabilities as well, but it is your fund balances to be rolled into the new fiscal year. And so what is your baseline starting point for 20?
And keep in mind that part of the reason that we do this is because, I know it's not on.
Well, it is on, it's not close enough, very close.
Part of the reason...
Rich, can we do anything about that? Rich?
This one's not working. Part of the reason that we do that is because it takes several months to get tax roll collections in, so we like to assign fund balance to give ourselves a starting operating reserve cushion so that we can continue to operate those first three or so months until really December, January, when those tax roll money start coming in. So that's really the purpose of this motion.
So this is a movement of funds to what? From where to where?
It's essentially just moving it, yeah, exactly, it's a carryover.
Carryover.
It's just allocating that $155,000 into your operating reserves, into your revenues, while you're awaiting additional tax funds, you can continue to fund your operations.
That's the motion?
Yes, it's essentially a book exercise.
Okay. Second on what Lindsay just said.
I'll make the motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? And the next item is a discussion on ratification of the fiscal year 2018 insurance policy.
Your insurance policy was up for renewal this year. It's the existing terms and conditions. And frankly, the board had not really had time to really think about what they wanted to do with respect to renewing your policy terms and conditions. This is basically the same policy you've had for the last 4 or 5 years, so I felt comfortable just renewing it. However, I did not renew it for its normal 2-year cycle. I renewed it for 1 year with the thought that the board might want to take a good look at this next time it comes around. So we'll be bringing this back to you in July, and I'm just letting you know that that was the intent, was to really get the board to have a chance to take a look at it and consider its options.
Chuck, would it be possible to get copies of the policy so that we can take a look at it? Because I've never seen one.
I've never seen one either.
So would you like, you want to see the existing policy before we get to the July timeline?
Yes, that's what I'm asking.
Be happy to do it.
Thank you.
So at this point in time, you've renewed it for 1 year?
Correct.
At a reduction, in fee?
Well, reduction in the budget.
Because I'm interested.
We budgeted a little bit more than it needed.
Okay.
I'm interested in looking at the levels of coverage, the deductibles and all of those types of things that were.
And I really felt that the board would want to do that. And that's why I'm bringing this up, because it is, I think it's an appropriate thing. And in that vein, I wanted to bring up the larger context of if you do end up with all of the amenities and assets, that really starting to think about insurance coverages is something I'd like, again, to approach the board and start thinking about those things going forward, that we'll need to start shopping those policies and those things when we get closer to the settlement coming around.
But separately under each category, we would keep the current CDD ponder rates and that type of thing under one policy, and the amenities would have to be under
another. Just like you, I watch the progressive commercials too, and bundling is always a good thing. So those are all.
Not necessarily.
I agree completely.
I'm still a licensed agent.
There you go. So, and that's why I did see a passion for having that greater conversation. Yeah.
Okay, so what kind of action do we need on that?
I'm bringing this up for conversation.
It might just be appropriate to have a motion to ratify the district manager's action in renewing your insurance coverage.
I will make that motion.
I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carried. Okay, next item on the agenda, staff reports by district attorney.
I don't have anything additional, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Next item on the agenda, our district engineer's report. None of those.
I don't have anything additional either.
Looks
fine. I don't want to talk to you.
Well, that's going to come up in the next. Well, I guess we can mention it now, right? I guess for those that do not know, Kathy Leo has, normally our representative, district engineer, has moved on to another company. And Michael.
You said it right the first time.
Did I?
Yeah. It's butchered so often it doesn't really matter. It's okay. Del La Soul.
Okay.
You said it right then.
All right. He's now going to be our representative from Atkins.
Yeah. Well, I plan on addressing that in general.
Thank you. Move on to the next item, and that be our field manager report.
Oh, you know why?
And our maintenance agreement.
Well, we've had some calls from weeks that actually came out back then. We had some calls, we got the pleasure of coming out and removing some dead fish out of 2 ponds. We did the hurricane check. We've been working on skimmer boards, fixing those on the control structures. We're up probably around $8,000 to $10,000 on that now. We're hoping to get that back through FEMA. We're just about done on that.
What happens to those?
What's that?
What happens to them?
You just get the water level comes up so high, you get so much pressure on the skimmer board sometimes, and after a while, some of the bolts will break, or some tap-ons that are in there. Some of the skimmer boards will actually break themselves.
And that's actually under FEMA?
We're going to try to climb that under FEMA, yes.
Well, it was...
Isn't it development?
That hurts the conversation we'd like to have with the board right now, actually.
Isn't that about the insurance?
Storm damage, insurance, correct. Again, your insurance coverages are generally for buildings and structures, okay? And for some liabilities associated with the pond. You don't really get pipe repair, pipe replacement, that kind of thing in your insurance coverages. The question really is, does the board want to go forward with a FEMA claim to try and recoup the expenses that we had for doing the repairs on the structures? Because they're not really insurance claims, but they are possible for FEMA claim. It looks like the number about short of $10,000, something like that, probably cost you $1,500 to $2,000 to do the claim, you know, provide the paperwork, submit it. Right now...
Why would it cost that?
That's just time and materials to do it.
Who's time?
The person who fills out all the paperwork, calls FEMA.
Isn't that you?
No, we have a vendor that does that. Well, it's...
Wouldn't that be under the contract? I mean, I don't understand, it's an extra expense.
Why is it an extra expense?
I don't get that.
Being outsourced.
To physically do the work.
Yeah.
Right, and make a request to FEMA.
It's not a district manager's job?
It's not to make FEMA requests for payment and the coordination thereof.
So it's not specifically line item that agreement with us?
Correct. It's not, I guess the point is that it's not a huge expense and it gets rolled into the request for funding. That doing the application is a fundable request that they will reimburse you to do. So that...
Yes, Chuck, I would like to see the initial paperwork or the document which specifically gives us the authority or the opportunity to file a request with FEMA. Does that make sense, Bob?
There's a very good website. It's called floridapa.org. It's short for floridapublicassistance.org. That's the process that needs to be navigated to recoup funds for storm-related damages to public assets.
Could you maybe share that website with us under separate email contract?
Sure, happy to.
If I may, we've run down this issue before, usually on larger claims. It doesn't make much sense to get us involved in a $10,000 claim. But one of the issues that you'll need to look at is FEMA sometimes has a requirement that if they give you the money back, that you then have to insure that facility that the money was used for. And I think we just heard that you don't typically insure pipes and things like that. So before you go down the road of spending money to file a FEMA claim, you need to get that insurance issue resolved, because it doesn't make any sense to spend $2,000 on something you're not going to insure later and comply with the FEMA requirements.
So it's twice I heard that it's probably not wise to, not.
No, I wouldn't say necessarily. I'm saying look at that issue, because when we looked at it before, we've been looking at claims that are, $200,000, $600,000 claims. And I know that there's a different process for a small claim, which I think is under $130,000-some, and a different process for a greater claim. All I'm saying is if somebody's looking at it, look at it and make sure that you're not accepting money that you may have to repay one day later, because you're not going to insure whatever it is you fix.
Mike, is there any differentiation between a quasi-governmental unit like we are versus a private individual filing a claim?
Yeah, there's a significant difference, and I would say that we fall in the same category as a city or a county. We're a full-fledged governmental entity in terms of that issue. We've got a memorandum that we've done on this. We can send it to the board if the board wants more information about it. I mean, these things are going to happen over and over again in terms of the storms, and certainly, if we take the amenities, that's a whole different issue in terms of FEMA storm damage that we'd have to deal with there. So,
because I would like to see like a policy statement to say this is what we can and can't do under this particular situation.
Yeah, we have, again, a memo that outlines those, that addresses this insurance issue as well. I just don't have it with me off the top of my head.
One of the important points, even if you review Mike's memo, is that every storm does come out with its own conditions and its own reimbursables and its own requirements. So while, you know, I'm sure Mike's report is very important and good to read, I would really suggest that you do go to their website, because it does talk about the storm specific. Again, the $121,000 is the cap. When insurance does come in to reimburse, that's deducted out. We've looked at this one. It's a low number, like I say. It's like $10,000. It's definitely a borderline no. But I wanted to make it available to you if you wanted us to go after it.
Is it? Well, Chuck, that's one reason why I'm interested in looking at the insurance policy, because you can, or it's possible, that you could have a rider which could be attached to that policy, which could actually cover occurrences such as the one we're talking about now, and not even involve FEMA.
My black shorts.
Yes.
Okay.
I'm opposed to going forward with this $10,000. I think it's a waste of time and money.
I would have to concur with Skip.
Okay, so the board's position, do you want to take a vote on that, is whether to proceed with FEMA claim or not, or at this point?
I would make a motion that we do not proceed with filing a claim for FEMA.
Second.
Okay, all in favor of that motion?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Right, I think we need to review the policy anyway.
Right, I agree.
That we need to look at right away.
I guess I totally agree. I think it's prudent for us to do that.
Okay, so we would like to.
Now, Chuck, would this include the insurance policies that we're also taking out for the tunnels? Because I think that there's a separate policy for that, isn't there?
I believe the tunnels are under this policy, but I'll make sure that you do get all of them.
So are the all inclusive?
Oh, yeah, I'll get you everything we do.
And what, and you know, I'd like to take a look at that website anyhow, so.
Yeah, please do. It's actually something you can
send me.
FloridaPA.org.
Okay. Okay. Sorry, Russ, we interrupted you. Is it?
That's from FEMA stuff. That was our.
Okay.
Good question.
Anything additional? No. Well, we're going to talk about the contract maintenance agreements in particular. Do we need any action on them? Do we need to ratify what the district manager has done?
And just for the board's edification, so.
Or our legal representatives have done the letter.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
Do we need to do anything about the letter that was written to Clark?
Yeah. So essentially, going back, looking at your landscape maintenance agreements, you can see the Clark agreements for both Midge and Aquatic expired at the end of September after our last board meeting, but obviously in advance of this one. So district staff took the liberty of extending that contract by letter on an interim basis so that the board can meet at the same terms, price, conditions, etc. So if we could have just a motion to ratify that action and that temporary extension, then we can go into where the board wants to go in terms of service providers.
Okay. I'll second that motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay. So your action has been ratified.
Thank you. So now the floor is open. You know, it's obviously up to you guys if you want to take them one by one or if you want to discuss them generally. Obviously, you have a little bit more time with landscape, but you have several options. You could either, if you're happy with the services now, you could authorize staff to enter into a new one-year agreement with these providers. You could also ask for additional proposals. It's really up to the board.
As far as I'm concerned, I'm
satisfied.
I'm along with Clark.
I think they're doing a great job.
Yeah, I'm satisfied.
Well, we have a motion.
I would agree.
Okay.
So, I'd like a motion for one indulgence from the board regarding the contracts.
Yes.
That's your floral lawn contract.
We're talking about Clark now.
Okay.
So we're talking about only Clark because that's expired already.
You
want floral lawn now also?
I think you already have a motion set, so just proceed with your motion and we can handle floral lawn next.
Okay. So there's a motion to approve a one-year contract for Clark?
Yes.
I'll move.
Same price and conditions.
Good job,
all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carried.
Okay.
I'm sorry. Mr. Walter, now 401, you were going to say?
Yes, 401. The board did a wise move, I believe, in having one contractor doing the pond banks and the flatbeds. And the wisdom in that is that you don't end up with a line. You have different contractors out there doing the two different services. However, there's been probably an expense of doing it that way as well. Looking through the contract, basically it's the same contract as the flatbed. Again, to try and keep terms and conditions as similar as possible. It was an understandable move at the time. However, you know, when we started looking into the midge issues that we have throughout the community, one of the things that's predominant in the literature is to reduce the source of pollutants to the maximum extent you can. And in the case of your landscape contract, you're applying fertilizer four times a year on pond banks. Because that was the same terms and conditions that you had in the flatbed.
I thought we corrected that in the last amendment we had.
I believe we did talk.
Are you sure you're looking at the right contract? Because
That's the contract.
Last year we went through and Mr. Moyer and Brian went through that contract and made adjustments to the HOA one to apply more appropriately to the ponds.
Yeah, because he even attended the meetings, because I'm on the landscape committee where we do the approval of the contracts. And I think he was present at those meetings. Because I know that he worked with Gary Consart on the agreement and we specifically did eliminate the fertilization for that particular reason.
Yeah, also, just to give you some history on that, okay? At one point when it was prior to Floralon, there was a contract to do all the maintenance and the cuttings. What they didn't do, we used to call it no man's land, was around the ponds. And so we had to go ahead and go in and John Corners had to come in and get an extra contract way back when.